So far, hopefully you are with me. There's caffeine out there if you aren't. But the point being, very interesting problem, a great technology problem to solve as well. And we think we are the right company to solve it because, you know, we are the server DNA. We need to actually not just keep on focusing on the SDDC data plane, which again, we need to, but we also should bring an equivalent amount of innovation in the control plane. And in fact, that is how we are going to actually be a very, very unique vendor. As most people actually are very one dimensional. They focus on one product and one product only. And so out there, we are going to actually unleash a new product on the world. So I'm going to show you what that product is and why it is different. We call it PernixData Architect. It is motivated towards this part of the IT lifecycle. So it is designed to help you design, operate, and optimize your data center, along with other complementary products that may or may not come from PernixData. You know, it may be a complementary storage system that you buy or a complementary server system, etc. Doesn't really matter. But we want to own this part of the IT lifecycle going forward. The way we do it, you know, first things first, and then we'll go into the details of why this is different and so on. But the first things first is the way it works is here you have your traditional data center, you have a bunch of servers connected to storage. And we add an agent to every server. That agent mines all kinds of VM and infrastructure information, our own information. We don't rely on other people. And we send it over to a data and analytics system that we have built. And you know, in some sense, you can actually think of this as the next generation of, you know, what we build for FVP's control plane, right? Some of you must be familiar, at least many of you are Pernix pros, and so you must be familiar with our control plane, our UI, and all the, you know, interesting ways we can slice and dice workloads. So this is the next generation. And so all the data goes in there, you know, we munch on it, we store it, and then we present results for the user, right? And way we present results is, of course, for three things, right? You know, some results are to help your design data center, your data center. Some results are to actually help you optimize what you're already running. And some results are to let you operate what you're already running. Yeah, in the big data world, this is, you know, bucketized into three categories, right? You know, predictive, prescriptive, and descriptive analytics. You know, descriptive analytics is just reporting on stuff that is going on in your data center. And, you know, just FYI. And, you know, prescriptive analytics is things, you know, actions you could take to make things better. And then predictive analytics is what if scenarios, right? What if I buy an all flash array and I roll it in, you know, is it going to work out? What if I change this virtual machine from write through mode to write back acceleration mode with FVP, et cetera? What if I double the size of my flash device in my storage system? What if I double the size of my flash device in the FVP cluster, et cetera? So that's the overall picture of what, you know, how the system is deployed. You know, a bunch of agents on every ESX server and some centralized agent to crunch all the numbers. I'm going to complicate the story later, so bear with me, but this is the first thing. Now, you know, I can actually give you a demo of the product, but, you know, a lot of products actually look alike. So what I figured we should do is I want to walk you through some design principles that we followed. And if you agree with me on the design principles, that these design principles are actually unique and very interesting for the end user, then you would agree that this is a very unique product. So rather than take you through a whirlwind tour of the UI, where I'm just going to show you very colorful things, I'm actually going to take you through a tour of the UI, but in the context of design principles. And there's three design principles that I want to talk about. So first one is get a lot of data and make it your own, right? So we have seen examples where, you know, and in fact, even for FVP, we rely on some VMware data, right? But it turns out that the data that is actually important for you to solve this problem might not be important to the guy who is providing it, I'll give you an example, right? Recently, there was a blog post. I forget, was it, which vendor it was, but they were talking about how in ESX 6.0, vCenter has changed how it provides stats, so you can't actually pull for stats very frequently, and they shut it down because it was a scalability problem. Well, that's very interesting, right? Is one guy's important problem is another guy's scalability problem. It's another guy's garbage. It's another guy's overhead. And so you can't be in that mode. If you're going to actually look at data, you need to mine it yourself, create it yourself. There's also a lot of data that doesn't come out of systems, but it's very important. And I'm going to show you a screenshot immediately after this slide. And so that's the other reason why you mine your own data, is other people don't produce the data you need. And the other reason you mine your own data is there's a lot of mismatch, right? If you are going to, try to compare a disk array's data store stats with what VMware provides, you'll see that there's some mismatch. And it turns out if you actually use that kind of mismatching things to provide an end-to-end analysis of what's going on in your data center, you're bound to go wrong. That's a butterfly effect again, right? You make small mistakes in the initial data set, the final outcome is going to be very, very different. So here's an example. Before I get into the example, let me orient you with the UI. So this is actually the Architect UI. Basic things first, it's a web-based UI, so you just log in through the browser. And it's nice. It's HTML, JavaScript, so yeah, it's a technical term. But, or at least that's how the engineers nowadays, explain it to me. It's Mr. CTO, it's nice. You got to say that. A lot going on, so don't worry about that. You don't need to focus on everything that's going on, but just a few things. So it's a browser-based UI. We, after a long time, and I'm going to show this to you for FAP as well, the next generation of FAP is going to break out of the web client and the VI client. Unfortunately, there's a technology mismatch, right? We want to focus mostly on some forward-looking technologies like HTML and JavaScript. And it's very hard to actually make all those things work in the context of a Flex-based application or a C-sharp-based application. So it was time to move on. Coming back, standalone thing, you see the drop-down there. So the other thing, at least I learned from my VMware days, and I'm sure many of you as well, is, there's no point in making, one UI for one application and then another UI for another application. So what you see out there is a unified UI. So you can just, click out there and you can go to FAP, right? So all the PernixData products all under the same UI, same login. So anyway, that's table stakes. Now coming to this view, again, I'm sure you are disoriented because we are not following a particular trail to get to this page. But we are at this page where it's not a dashboard page. We are in the infrastructure and we are not the summary. We are actually diving deep into the infrastructure. And we are looking at all the VMs you are running in your data center, and there's some stats going on. You don't have to worry about it. What I want to actually focus on is this part of the UI, right? Is this is data that was previously not available. And in fact, this is data that you actually can't get from vCenter, right? So you got to, this was the point I was trying to make, is if you actually want interesting data, and in this case, what I'm showing is, for every virtual machine that is running in your data center, you could ask the system, or at least, you don't even have to ask, you in the summary view, you see what the common block sizes the virtual machine issues to the storage system, and what the read-write mix is. This is data that is not available natively. And so we have to actually, look at every packet that goes through the system to find this, and which is also why it's a big data problem, right? Looking at every packet. Now, here's the power of what this will do. if you can make it happen, right? So I'm right now in the summary view. It's showing a read-write split, and it's showing the most common block sizes, right? So in this case, this virtual machine is, you know, it issues 4K, 4K to 8K, and, you know, greater than 256K, maybe during backup windows. And this was observed over the last day, but, you know, clearly virtual machines change personality during the day, right? You know, in the night, maybe it's the backup personality, maybe in the day, it's the bootstrap personality or whatever. And so you can also, as you change the frequency of, I'm sorry, the time interval of what you're looking at, this data will change, right? Now, the reason this is very interesting, well, first of all, is this is your VM's footprint, I'm sorry, fingerprint, right? If you click on another VM, immediately, like literally in 10 seconds, you can actually look at that read-write mix, you know, type of block sizes it issues, and you can very quickly see which VMs are similar and which VMs are different. And so you can very quickly categorize VMs, right, without actually depending on the application administrator. In fact, that's another problem that happens in data centers today, right? You think you are running VDI VMs, but guess what? The guy is actually uploading Techfield video to the internet, and that's not VDI VMs. But so, you know, unfortunately, what people think they are running versus what they are actually doing is two very different things. And even if they start the same, they actually diverge very quickly, right? And so we are solving that problem. Yeah, here's a very interesting example that happened very recently is, you know, Pure Storage, for example, will tell you that, you know, the average block size that they see in data centers is 32 kilobytes. That's very interesting. You know, Nimble recently published a blog post, right? And they showed that the average data size, the most popular block size that they see in their installs is 16 kilobytes. Now that's very interesting, you know, two different data points, very, very different as well. But it turns out, if you actually calculate an average block size for a VM that is showing some 4K IOs, some 8K IOs, and some 256K IOs, guess what the answer is going to be? 64K. Is the VM issuing 64K IOs? No. And that is the problem. So now you are going to actually, when you are trying to do a storage refresh, you are going to run IOMeter with 64K block size because apparently that's what your VM is doing, but it's not. What you should actually be doing is, you know, if you go into, you know, a little bit of detail, look at IO frequency, then here's a frequency chart of the block sizes the VM is doing. You know, dark green is the most frequent block size, you know, the gray and the yellows are the least frequent block sizes. And so now you can see that, you know, the real way to actually characterize this VM through an artificial workload, if you want to do it at all, if you care to do it at all, is to actually issue these block sizes at this frequency through IOMeter. And so that is the big deal about actually collecting the right data in your data center and actually doing the right analytics on it. You know, you don't calculate an average of block sizes because the answer you get is absolutely non-relevant for any decision that you actually want to take in your data center. And again, don't get me wrong, you know, this is a progression of things, right? You know, in fact, we have learned what doesn't work, which is why we are able to build this thing. So I'm not saying that, well, you know, it was a hallelujah moment. It's just a constantly evolving game, right? But this is why we are very proud of what we have created, PernixData Architect, is, you know, a lot of thought has gone into each and everything that you actually see on the screen. You know, the number of things you see, you know, which is often the focus, is like, oh, look, you know, look at my dashboard, you know, 15 green buttons, and look at the other dashboard, just 5. That's not interesting. This is enterprise class. This is SMB class. No, you know, it's the quality of data. And you got to work really, really hard to get that quality of data. That's our DNA. Yeah, same visualization. You know, this is the distribution of block sizes that VM is doing over the last 24 hours. And that's very interesting too, right? Because, you know, I just said it earlier, but, you know, VMs actually change personalities if you look at them in the night versus if you look at them in the day and so on and so forth. VMs change personality if you actually upgrade the database version, right? VMs change personality when you go from Windows XP to Windows 7. You know, suddenly a read-only workload becomes a write-mostly workload. So, you know, that is what this gets you, right? Is how did an application evolve in my data center? And of course, I'm just showing you the last 24 hours, but you can just as well, you know, go there and look at the last year. You can look at the last 3 months and so on. That is a conversation you have with your CIO as to why things are broken in your data center. It's because for the first time, you can say that, look, you know, we designed for this, but I'm seeing that. Or you can even say that we didn't design for that. Let's buy some FVP. That was a joke. But it's getting late in the day. Here's another example of how you can get the right data. And if you can get it, then, well, it's very difficult. But if you can get it, it's awesome, right? So out here, we are showing for every virtual machine that you are running in your data center, we are actually showing you the working set, where I'm defining the working set as the amount of data that is hot for that virtual machine in a given time period. And the reason working sets are very important is, for example, if you are actually deploying a storage system or if you are deploying FVP or whatever, then you need to know how much data is hot. And so that's the amount of high performance media that you need to deploy in your data center. You need to deploy as much high performance media as the sum of all these curves. The other interesting thing about showing this information is, you know, if you look at it, you know, this is the read working set, that's the write working set, the stuff in orange. Now, if you deploy a read-only system, it's not going to help this guy, but it might help that guy. Well, that guy. And so, you know, it also lets you take many other interesting decisions as to whether the technology you're deploying is actually right. It's not just about making it fast, but it's making it fast for the right data. So, you know, again, just an example. There's, you know, tons of other things. I'm not going to do a exhaustive kind of, you know, trail of the UI because that'll take too long. And it's not important. What is important is to understand why this is very unique. And so the right data. You know, to actually calculate working sets, you have to literally look at every I/O that is going on in the system and over some time, and then you figure out, you know, a virtual machine that is writing, you know, a single sector 1,000 times has a different working set than a different virtual machine which is writing 1,000 sectors in the same amount of time, right? This one has a working set 1,000 times bigger than this virtual machine. And that is something that you can gain only by looking at every I/O. So it's a very hard problem to solve if you want to solve it. There's a lot of goodness that'll come out of it, which is why we are solving it. You know, the second principle I want to talk about is, you know, controlling the user experience. You know, we've seen that a lot of control plane products are actually looked at as pure overhead. You know, you don't log into vCenter unless you really want to. It doesn't actually make your day. You don't log into whatever your, you know, dashboard product is, because it doesn't make your day. You know, you are mostly trying to get away from it. And the reason you get away from it is because every time you log in, you're overwhelmed with the amount of information there is. And so it's like doing taxes, right? You know, does anyone do taxes manually in this room? Probably not. And so, or let me rephrase, does any moron do taxes manually?
No, we just hire people and pay them a lot of money to do our taxes for us.
There you go. That's even worse. But I use TurboTax. I'm a control freak. So, you know, TurboTax, I'm sure I've gone wrong. But anyway.
Which is essentially hiring somebody, sort of.
Yeah, exactly. In a manner of speaking, right? That's your guy. Yeah. And so, you know, the thing that works with doing taxes is that, you know, it's very, very overwhelming if you are actually presented with the task of doing taxes. But then if somebody actually guides you through it, and every step of the way, you have only one decision to make and nothing more, then it's quite okay. You know, 24 hours later, you're done. And so that is needed for data centers, right? It's actually, you know, not everybody is a VCDX, right? So there's no point in showing 1,000 graphs and actually letting it be on the user to interpret what's interesting to see. We should guide people. And if you control that user experience, they will learn. And if they learn, they will come back for more. So it's about building products where actually they want to come back every morning because they learn something, you know, by going through an interesting path. And so that's another thing that we focused on, and I'm going to show you some examples, right? So here, you know, now we are in a different part of architecture. So we are in the dashboard view. And this is a very, very, very high level view, right? And so you are actually looking at your VC clusters. And hopefully you just have a few clusters. So, you know, you'll have some, you know, enough, as many tiles as the number of clusters. And you are seeing a few things. I'm going to explain it in a second. But before I go there, you know, one thing I forgot to mention is I'm actually showing you a lot many examples, you know, to actually keep it hopefully comprehensible. I am focusing a whole bunch on storage, right? But you can actually hopefully see that, you know, similar examples actually exist in the networking space or the CPU space, whatever. But, you know, storage happens to actually be very, very tricky because it's a distributed systems problem. And so that's the reason why I chose storage examples. Plus, you know, I understand storage.
But does the Pernix, does the architect show those, like CPU and memory or networking? Or does it only do storage?
Good point. So very primitive on that part. And, you know, that is intentional, because we wanted to focus on actually doing a great job, a very unique job for an important part of the data center, and but you know, not go very broad, because then we would never finish the product. Over time, we would love to actually focus on more and more components, right? But this is the same principle as FPP, right? You know, the first time we did FPP, we could have done it for Hyper-V as well. But, you know, it was more important to actually do write-back with fault tolerance in a VMware-only product than to do two products, both of which do read-only caching, right? So that is very important. Otherwise, you know, you just missed the, you just lost the battle, right? You know, the guy's not going to use it. If it's not going to use it, there's no point in saying that tomorrow I'm going to do fault tolerance, right? So, but no, great observation. And in fact, we are, you know, we are unabashed about trying to focus on mostly storage networking, because, you know, that's a distributed systems thing, right? You know, a thing that this virtual machine does off of this host to the storage system actually has a ripple effect on this virtual machine that is running on this host. But if you look at CPU and memory, you know, if you are saturated for CPU here, has no ripple effect on the amount of CPU here or memory, right? That is the reason why we chose the storage and, you know, the network problem. So now coming back here, you know, if you look at this, well, you know, this is just information. What's interesting about this? Well, what's interesting about this is we are actually trying to control you from clicking further. And so if we succeed in controlling you from clicking any further, then we've done a great job, right? As you know, suddenly just in one UI, you know everything that you need to know during your morning coffee. And if that is the case, you will actually come visit us. If it happens to be the case that you need to double click, then it's going to take an hour to do things. And if it takes an hour to do things, you're not going to come visit us every day or every week. So this is very important. Well, so what can you figure out from here? Well, you can figure out, so out here, for example, I'm showing, you know, for this cluster, we are on the per VM breakdown. And so we are showing of all the virtual machines that are running on your cluster, what is the distribution of write heavy VMs versus write moderate VMs versus balanced VMs versus read moderate VMs, read heavy VMs, etc. And then, for example, you know, you could have clicked on the read write summary, and then we are showing you for this entire cluster, what is the read write distribution going out to your storage system, all your storage systems connected to this cluster. Oh, why is this interesting? And think about it. You know, when you architecture your data center, maybe you are setting up a SAP cluster or maybe a VDI cluster or whatever. And the way you spec'd out that cluster is, well, you know, it's going to run so many virtual machines and it's going to do so many IOPS and it's going to be a read mostly workload, etc. And you come in the morning and you see if your cluster is running the virtual machines that you thought you designed for. And it's running the read-write mix that you thought you designed your data center for, your host, your servers, you know, and your storage system. And then, for example, you know, by, again, going, exploiting the power of time, you can actually see whether, you know, if it's off today, when was the last time it was actually okay? And then, you know, now you know what, how to go further, right? You know, you can figure out what changed because you know when it was okay and then, you know, when it's not okay. So, you know, very high level view, but this is literally the fingerprint of your vSphere cluster. If your fingerprint changes, then the personality of what you are running has changed. For example, if you deploy Hadoop VMs in your cluster, then this will absolutely change tomorrow. And when you come in tomorrow, you will know. And imagine that, right? You know, the other way of operating your data center is you will only know that somebody deployed 500 Hadoop VMs in your cluster when something goes red. But is that good? You know, why did you wait so far? Why did you actually wait for something to go wrong to know about that change? You should know every day, or well, every 2 days. So that's the power of, you know, this progressive disclosure, right? You start up at the high level, you can get a lot of answers just, you know, being at the high level. But then, of course, if you want to go deeper, you get to go deeper. Here's a similar view of the cluster, right? So out here, we are showing the working set of all the virtual machines on the cluster going out to the storage system. Well, you know, if you have deployed a storage system which doesn't have 180 gigabytes of read and write flash cache, then of course you are going to go wrong, right? Bam, problem solved. So you don't need to go any further. You know whether it's okay or not okay, and so on and so forth. And those, by the way, those are the conversations you want to have with your CIO, right? You don't want to really talk about debugging one virtual machines. So it's very important to actually, you know, go from the top to the bottom. Ideally, you know, not even go to the bottom if you can avoid it. Here's another view, right? So this is the working set for your entire cluster. But then, for example, if you're an FAP customer, then you know, you've deployed flash devices or memory inside every host, and that is being used as a read and write acceleration medium. So it is very important for you to know whether, you know, the working set of the host fits the flash device that you have deployed in that host. And so you can actually slice and dice it on the per host level. So you can go from the cluster to the host and so on and so forth, eventually to the VM. But every level that you traverse actually answers a different set of questions in terms of data center design, data center optimization, and data center operations. And you know, the funny thing about this product is it's not actually meant to solve a particular use case that I prescribe to you. It is meant for you to discover interesting ways you are going to use it. And our job in that world is to control your user experience such that you actually take the time or the effort to even discover all the use cases, interesting things that you can use this product for. Because the problem with these products is that you're going to get frustrated before you even kind of get to the next level, right? Is that, you know, why is this interesting? So we are trying to first minimize frustration. Here's another high level view, right? So this is your two clusters, two virtual center clusters, running a whole bunch of virtual machines, one in dark blue, one in light blue. And so we are plotting latency that the virtual machine sees on the y-axis and the throughput that the virtual machine sees on the x-axis. Well, why is that important? The reason it's important is because, again, instead of waiting for something to go red, because you know the only time something is going to go red is if a product detects that the average throughput of a virtual machine is a statistical anomaly compared to the current throughput of the virtual machine is a statistical anomaly compared to what the virtual machine does on a daily basis, right? But your problem is not to wait for the statistical anomaly. Your problem is to see that, well, look, you know, if I can do something better for this set of virtual machines that are actually seeing very high latency for very low throughput, then maybe I should. And so this is the data center design problem, right? This is not the data center operations problem. And so we, again, want people to focus on that, and we want them to actually visit this on a daily basis to figure out what else they can do in their data center to run things better. And so out here, again, you know, you can very quickly see that this is really the only population of VMs worth troubleshooting. And of course, they are not red, but it's worth looking into. And so then you look at them, you know, one of them, and then you are in this view where you're seeing latency for a particular cluster, I guess, but you know, you can do the same thing for a VM, and you see a spike. Well, why did it spike? Now, this is again progressive disclosure, right? And this is the AI thing that I talked about, right? As you know, we try to understand concepts in a data center. You know, why do latency spike? They typically spike when interesting things happen. You know what that red ball is? It's an interesting thing that happened. So the first thing you do is you actually click on that red ball, and there's two events waiting for you right there. And those are probably the causative factors for that latency spiking. Now, of course, there are many other events in the data center that did nothing, and that's totally fine. But this is the power of progressive disclosure, right? Is you don't need to look at 1,000 charts. The two things that you need to look at are waiting for you. And the reason they are waiting for you is the computer has already figured out maybe this is caused by these two things, right? And so then, of course, you know, if you really, really, really want to, are curious, then you click on it. And then we, again, controlling your user experience, we take you to the next level, right? Out here, we are showing you the 10 highest latency VMs. And this is, you know, we went from this cluster view to 10 highest latency VMs because we understand that the reason you clicked on that spike is because you are probably afraid of the spike, and there's no point in looking at all the VMs. There's only, you know, maybe one of these is what you're looking for. There's no point in showing you the other 100 that are actually running fine. So again, you know, controlling the user experience. You are never overwhelmed. And then of course you can, you know, you can do secondary breakdowns, right? So for that latency, show me the read and write latencies, because maybe it's only a write problem. Nothing's, you know, nothing's wrong with reads and so on and so forth. And of course you can, as you can see, you now have two levers and you can, you know, turn one at a time. But again, we are controlling you, and you are going to discover exactly, you know, you are going to follow a script that the product has laid out for you. Now, I understand the problems of controlling the user experience, right? As what if we go wrong? You can't actually deviate and go to this power mode. And you know, that's good. That's good. And the way you get power mode is through APIs. And it's good enough. But for the average user, this is what they hopefully what they really want, right? For the average guy in, you know, having many other problems. Luke?
Would that set be extensible? Can the user add scenarios in what you present there? Or?
Good point. So right now the user can't, you can consume our data and you can actually draw your own conclusions, etc., or your own visualizations. You can't add to our UI. So the other thing, and actually thanks for reminding me, but the other thing we have avoided in this product, no plugins. And the reason there are no plugins is because every plugin, if you look at it, you know, brings in another chart, which is not related to the 10 other charts that you're seeing. And that's not a good user experience. So last thing I want to talk about, and you said 5 minutes, is that right? Okay. Last thing I want to talk about architect design principles, is we are focused, you know, you must have heard about recommendations, right? You know, products in this space, you know, if you're in the control plane, you're looking at all this data, obviously you're going to make some recommendations. So what is the difference between making a recommendation and making a recommendation? And the difference is, you know, you can recommend that this virtual machine is suffering from a problem and hence move it to another host or change the data store for that virtual machine. That is, you know, the state of the art in recommendations, and that's a good first step. But you know, we failed to ask the obvious question: is what this virtual machine is doing actually what it should be doing? And so, we are actually focusing the product on making recommendations, which is not about, well, you know, you should, you know, move this virtual machine to this other host, or you should move this virtual machine to this other data store, or you should add more CPU to this host. We are not focused on that part of the problem. What we actually look at is, because of all that data that we are collecting, we are actually trying to ask the obvious question, which is never asked, is the application doing what the application administrator expected it to do? And most of the times, it turns out that things are misbehaving because the application is not doing what it's what it was, you know, theoretically supposed to do. And that's a great conversation to be had between the infrastructure administrator and the application administrator in the first place. Instead of, you know, the infrastructure administrator always busy moving virtual machines around, and the application administrator always, you know, ticked off at the infrastructure administrator because the guy just can't get it done. You know, maybe the infrastructure administrator asks some more meta question. Is it actually reasonable that this application is doing 256 kilobytes of IOs all the time? And maybe the guy can tune something about it. That's the conversation worth having. So we are focused on that. Now again, first things first, you know, different view of the UI. Again, we are in architect, we're in the infrastructure pane. This is the operations part, right? Red, green, you know, just to kind of put a check mark on the PRD. But what we want to focus on is here, right, is recommendations. And specifically, what I want to focus on is the quality of recommendations. And so out here, the recommendations we are making are not the recommendations that you are typically used to seeing. For example, we are making a recommendation on this virtual machine that it's running a lot of large block size IOs. And so the real problem to solve with that virtual machine is not to actually move it around to fast storage, but actually work with the application administrator to figure out if it can actually issue less large block size IOs. And if you can do that, problem solved. This other virtual machine, this is a FVP type recommendation, right? Where we are saying that you are better off running this in write acceleration mode because we are seeing a lot of write. There's overlapping IOs. If you look at any storage system, if you actually try to do IOs to the same sector, they don't perform as well as if you try to do IOs to different sectors. You know, very known problem. You know, unaligned IOs is another known problem, right? And in fact, unaligned IOs is a very interesting problem, right? Is a recommendation system where it says that, look, you know, this virtual machine is suffering from a problem, move it. Is that going to do anything for unaligned IOs? No. Until you solve the unaligned IOs problem, that virtual machine is going to keep on sucking wherever you move it. And so you need to actually solve that root cause, and that's what we focus on. Reason we can focus on that is because we get data that is actually not native to things like vCenter and so on. So that's, you know, the third part, which is we want computers to do more. But we are actually working on a recommendation engine which actually makes you very non-intuitive recommendations. And recommendations that a human would have eventually made if they had spent a lot of hours working, chasing the problem. So in summary, you know, that's the product. And of course, I'm more than happy to answer more questions about it. But, you know, in summary, that's a product. We are going to attack this control plane problem. And the reason we want to attack it is because for the first time, we actually want to make this a learning platform. We want to make the software-defined data center control plane from an operational crap, you know, platform to, you know, something that you're genuinely interested in interacting with. And, you know, the time has come. We are in the year 2015. And, you know, something that is relevant, you know, to the, you know, operations guy, it's relevant to the architect guy, it's relevant to the CIO, because the guy has the same questions. Is how are our workloads changing? How did the workload change last year versus this year, etc.? So that's architect. Now, if you are listening, you know, there are many unanswered questions, right? Is now Architect is a product which will answer a lot of questions inside your data center. It'll hopefully help you design your data center much better, help you optimize, operate your data center in a much better way. But the real question is, well, for example, if you're a cook, the question is, am I running my data center at the same efficiency level as Pepsi? And well, guess what? You don't have the answer. If you're a Wells Fargo, am I running my data center the same way as the other 20 banks are running? And so on and so forth. No answer. And that's because enterprise IT doesn't share information. And that's a pretty sad thing, right? Again, in the year 2015. Very simple things is, you know, I would like to know if companies my size are upgrading to vSphere 6.0. I would like to know if the Cisco guy is pitching me Cisco UCS as the next big thing. I would like to know if the world in the last 3 months has actually seen a great amount of adoption of Cisco UCS system for virtualization. I would like to know that. If some guy is pitching me some hybrid storage system, I would like to know what it does on an average IOPS throughput basis. I would like to know how many average number of VMs per host. What is the average size of, you know, virtual disks? Do people use VMware snapshots? Do they not? I would like to know all those things so that I can actually do a better job with my data center. And that is information that you can never get. You can actually write an email to your other buddy that works in the other data center. You get a point in time observation. And oh, by the way, that is wrong too, because the guy doesn't have architect, right? But you know, that point in time observation is out of date by the time the email reaches you.